Good evening, everyone. I'm Raja Reddy here, Head of Marketing and Medical from Servier India. Welcome to this short course on medico-legal issues. As I was just sharing with our course director, Dr. Ashwini Kumar Sethia, just around, you know, during the pandemic, we have realized that because of telemedicine, the practice of telemedicine in large scale, there were various issues which raised curiosity for medical legality as such among healthcare professionals. So it's around a month ago, we reached out to Dr. Sethia and requested him to build, organize, and deliver a short course on medical legal issues. And I'm very thankful to him for all the time spared, his passion on this subject, which you will see very shortly. But before I hand over to him, I would like to take this few minutes to introduce to you the philosophy of Servier. In India, we are known as Serdia, which is the first three letters of Servier and the last three letters of India. Servier is an international pharmaceutical company, which is governed by a non-profit foundation. I'm making a very profound statement here. At least to my knowledge, the only other pharma company which was a non-profit foundation was the Wellcome Group. That was some time ago. And Dr. Servier believed passionately that money earned from medicine should not belong to individuals. You will be surprised to know, when he passed away 7 years ago, Servier Group was valued around 4 billion euros. At that time, he had four children, but none of them inherited the company. He created a non-profit foundation. If you will wonder what is the objective of a non-profit foundation or why is it so different? The first thing, because we are a non-profit, we are not under pressure to deliver returns for shareholders on the stock market. So Servier, as I said, today Servier Medicines, 100 million patients are treated worldwide with Servier medicines. We are a leader in cardiovascular area, second in Europe, fifth worldwide. The other unique thing about Servier, because we are a non-profit, 25% of our total revenue is invested in R&D. To just let you know, the best pharma company in the world today will invest probably 8 to 10% of their net profit in R&D. But here we are, investing 25% of our total revenue in R&D. And that is possible because we are a non-profit. The other thing, because we are a non-profit, Servier is a very human company. I have spent 27 years in this company because we are a very human company. You will typically find Servier people all over the world spending, you know, it's very rare nowadays, but once they join the company, almost 80 to 90% of their people spend their entire lifetime with the company. I have only one slide on my products here. This session is not to promote our products, but to let you know these are our products. This is the only slide in the entire session you will find on our products. But there are three things what I will share about Serdia in India. For long, Servier in India supports brands which are produced in India. So the brands are manufactured in India. You know, recently we have come across a fact that 70% of all the bulk drugs in India come from China. It's a threat to our sovereignty. Servier traditionally all over the world, including in India, has no Chinese API. It was the founder's dream, Dr. Servier's dream, whether it is a patient in India, whether it is a patient in UK, they should get the same quality. So what you will find today, for example, a Damicron brand, if you purchase in India, you would purchase in UK, it's sourced from the same factory all over the world, the raw material. So I would also like to thank all the healthcare professionals because you formed the frontline against COVID. The pandemic is continuing. Thank you for your selfless service, not only doctors, nurses, supply chain staff, and pharmacists. This is a small introduction about this course. So we have six sessions. It's a very short course. Today's session, we have, it's a primer for the buffet you're going to have. Dr. Ashwini Kumar Sethia, once again, I'm very thankful And each day, each Saturday, more or less, we have a 1 hour, we have interactive live session with session archive. So it's a, you can go back and log in into the session again. You can request our colleagues to download the session for you. There is also a knowledge quiz where the winners are announced at the end of the day. But before I hand over to Dr. Ashwini Kumar Sethia, it's my honor. Very rarely you can find a person who's not, healthcare for me itself is very challenging. Gastroenterology, a super specialization. And you also have a specialization in law. This is possible only because of the passion. Dr. Sethia is a senior consultant gastroenterologist and hepatologist, program director, Max Super Speciality Hospital, New Delhi, and is an advisor and consultant in medical law and ethics. That's a very small introduction. You will find his passion on this subject, which I have experienced a little. My colleague Poonam has experienced it more about when we were interacting with him to design the subject. With that very small introduction I had, sir, I can say the screen is yours. I will stop sharing here. You can share your screen and first you share your screen and the screen is yours, sir. Yes, sir, your screen is visible for us.
Thank you, Mr. Reddy, for introductions and those kind words. I must thank Servia Pharmaceuticals for giving me the honor of having this platform to share my views and to share whatever little I have and to make aware my colleagues of this nasty thing which is on our heads. I am overwhelmed, honored, and privileged to have such a good number of audience. I'm told that there are more than 1,000 registrations, and I'm actually humbled by that, more so because in the audience, I'm aware that there are legal luminaries, that there are judges, and above all, I have a teacher of mine, Dr. S.L. Brewer, who's a gastroenterologist, and I really feel blessed that he would be there attending this session. I hope I don't let any one of you down. So, what is the need of this primer? The need is doctors are covered under more than 60 different laws, acts, and applicable regulations. A very painful thing is also that they can be prosecuted simultaneously, parallelly, in 12 different courts or commissions or platforms simultaneously. For example, Consumer Protection Act, under Consumer Protection Act, criminal courts, civil courts, Human Rights Commission, Medical Council of India, State Medical Council, to just name a few. There are many others which are going to be, which you can go to. No one who practices medicine is insulated, including government doctors, including doctors in armed forces, autonomous bodies, charitable dispensaries. So it concerns all of us, all of us. That is why there is a big need of learning about this. Most of you would know it, but it is again a shocking thing that there is no cap so far on the compensation that can be awarded. And the patients do ask for more. You'll be surprised to know that the courts have awarded compensations and claims much more than asked for. Again, prosecution can extend to your legal heirs even if you die. By late career, almost 2/3 of doctors have been sued. What the data I'm presenting is in the US, but India is closely following that trend. Obstetricians and gynecologists, general surgeons are sued the most, and pediatricians and psychiatrists the least. And this trend of increasing malpractice complaints is same in India also. And look at this picture. What doesn't happen in the US happens with sickening regularity in India. On your left is a friend of mine, gastroenterologist from Allahabad, who was savagely beaten about 4 years ago. One of our brethren from Bengal. And when we petitioned the Prime Minister, these are the pictures, what you see on your screen now. I do not know whether we need to resort to this, but we are called upon to resort to such tactics almost every day. This is a slide from my research to know what the magnitude of the problem is. And as you can see on the graph on your left, that the cases against doctors, the complaints against doctors are rising. From 2013 onwards, there is a sharp rise in the percentage of the cases of medical negligence filed in national commission and state commissions, as opposed to the district commission, district fora. New complaints in Delhi Medical Council alone have doubled in just about 2 or 3 years. And currently it is almost one complaint every working day. So you can imagine the problem with a yawning that it is there staring at us. Now, I'm not here to tell or teach something about medical law. What concerns us most, all of us, is medical negligence. So let's see what negligence is. By definition, negligence means lack of proper care. Therefore, by this definition, it is only very subjective. Therefore, it cannot be precise because there are no measurements of subjectivity. There are no measurements of what negligence is. So to understand it better, it is opposite of diligence. It consists of two acts, either of omission or commission. So what is omission? The act of not doing something which a reasonable doctor under the circumstances would do. And commission, act of commission, is doing something which a reasonable man under the circumstances would not do. But there is something called as actionable negligence. Not everything can be taken action on. So when there are four criteria that have to be met, there is a duty of doctor towards the patient. Now, how do you know whether there is duty of doctor towards the patient? If you hold out yourself to be a doctor and a patient comes to you, this duty sticks to you or adheres to you. Second, there has been a breach or dereliction of duty. Third, and there is a damage caused to the patient. The most important point is the last one, that this damage has to be consequential. This damage has to be a direct result of such a dereliction. I'll give you a small example. A patient comes to you in your chamber or in the hospital, and you're examining the patient, and the patient has a heart attack and dies. Now, there has been a damage caused, but it has not been caused because of your examination. So there is no nexus between dereliction of the duty. In fact, it will not be probably termed as dereliction of duty at all. So there has to be a consequential damage to your action. What is breach of duty of care? It is two things have to be met with. Doctor has fallen below the standard of care prescribed. That is, standard of care expected from a reasonable man. Now, this term reasonable is not exactly imaginary, but you would find that it is there almost in every law, because law would say what an average thing is, who's supposed to be reasonable. So it is a standard of care expected from a reasonable man under the same circumstances. Also, that practice which departs from standard practiced by a responsible body of medical persons skilled in the particular area of medicine in question. This has come from a test called as Boehlem's test of Boehlem's law. We are not going into that at all, but this is what the definition of that would be. Or failure to conform to required standard of care resulting in material injury is an actionable negligence. Standard of, how is it judged? What is the standard of care? It is judged by not the Clapham omnibus, the top floor of that. It is judged by a standard of an average practitioner of class to which the doctor belongs or holds himself to belong. I would divert a little and I'll give you an example of a Bombay High Court judgment in which a doctor, a gynecologist, was held liable because he held himself to be the most expert and the best gynecologist in the city and was not aware, not available for the delivery of the patient. And that is why he was held liable. So the standard of care is judged by standard of an average practitioner, which you, to which you belong or to which you hold yourself to belong. Expected standard of care depends on various other factors. For example, it is higher in case of specialists. A patient who goes with a chest pain to a cardiologist, standard of care is expected more from him than from a general physician and than from a pure MBBS doctor. And it is supposed to be higher in hospital versus primary health center because the equipment is not there, etc. It is supposed to be higher in the hospital itself when the patient has a problem in the OT versus what he has in wards. For example, if the patient has a cardiac arrest in OT, the standard of care is definitely higher than what if he has a cardiac arrest in the ward. And also, there may be one or more perfectly proper standards, and you can apply any one of them, or you can adapt any one of them. Very important thing now, what is not negligence? Error of judgment is not negligence. Accidents happen every day. In daily life, they can happen even while the patient comes to you. So accident is not negligence. Certainly inherent complication, but the disclaimer here is, and the attached thing is, if it is well explained at the time of taking consent, will not be considered as negligence. However, if you've not explained it and it happens, then people will take you to the court because this was not explained. An act done in good faith is certainly not negligence, whatever the harm. I'll come to that thing little later. A simple lack of care, which will not be considered as negligence. And as I mentioned earlier, the standards of judgment are those of a reasonably competent man and not of the most skilled in that field. What is the average? What is in the bell-shaped curve, which we find in 90 percentile, not the outliers. Following a practice which is acceptable to the medical profession on that day, even if a better or other alternative is available on that day, is not negligence. So for example, a patient comes to you with cholelithiasis, with stones in the gallbladder, and you say because of one reason or the other, you do an open cholecystectomy. Now, this is not something wrong. It is acceptable. A better alternative may be a laparoscopic cholecystectomy, but because of one reason or the other, you chose to do an open cholecystectomy. That is certainly not negligence. Now, what are the remedies? Remedies in law, legal remedies are consumer law, where in the consumer courts, the patient can go and file a complaint or a case where the compensation is payable for deficient services. Criminal law, remedies there in criminal law also, when any grossly negligent act is done. And here, the punishment is there, which is imprisonment. Here, usually, most often, the compensation is not given most often. I'm not saying always, most often. Law of torts, which is in the civil courts, tort means when there is a conduct which is twisted or wrongful. That is what tort means. So breach of duty here would give rise to a civil cause of action. And finally, there is law of contract under which we are also covered, which is rendering medical services for consideration. That is what we are doing. So you enter into a contract by definition, by legal definition. So if there is deficient service, then the compensation is awarded. In fact, a consent is a kind of a contract or an agreement which is legally held. Is consent is that contract. We have special sessions for these consent and documentation in coming few weeks, and more will be discussed about that. Now, what is the limitation period? There is a fixed period after the lapse of which the courts do not entertain suits, appeals, or claims in most cases. But the courts have got the power, authority, and liberty to waive off that period. Now, under the Consumer Protection Act, in the consumer fora, it is within 2 years that you have to file the complaint. In the civil courts, it is 1 year, and it starts only after the damage has taken place. I'm not going into the discovery rule, which will be dealt with when the Consumer Protection Act is discussed in one of the other sessions. Contractual claim within 3 years, and criminal law, if an offense is punishable with fine only, then the limitation shall be about 6 months. 1 year if imprisonment term does not exceed 1 year, and 3 years for a term exceeding 1 year but not exceeding 3 years. I'm briefly going to discuss the basis of Consumer Protection Act and the services included. The basic principle is to ascertain a liability which is there similar as dealt with in civil courts, that is under the law of torts. The principle remains the same. And what services are included? So all the services by a medical practitioner, except when he sees everyone free. These three words are very, very important. When he sees everyone without charging. So you cannot say that I did not charge a particular patient because he was poor or he was known or he was familiar or whatever, and do not issue the receipts, you are still liable under the Consumer Protection Act, whether or not you've charged. For that to occur, you have to see every patient free. So services at a non-government hospitals where charges are required to be paid, that is included. Further, where some pay, others don't, that also is included. And even in the government hospitals, where some people pay and some services are payable. For example, when the CT scan equipment came, it was very expensive that the government decided to charge some charges from the patient, and they would then be covered under Consumer Protection Act. Also, that let's say that the patient is not paying, but the insurance company is paying, fair enough, you're still, the services are included. And even when the employer pays on the behalf of the patient can still sue the doctor. Now let us see which services are out of purview of Consumer Protection Act. Contract of personal service, as opposed to contract for personal service. This is English. And in contract of personal service, there is a relationship of an employee and employer. Here, a man is employed as a part of business where the master is the employer, therefore can be directed by him to do whatever. Whereas in contract for service, his work, although done for the business, is not entirely integrated into it, but only accessory to it, number one. And number two, he is master of his own will, whatever he wants to do after being given the order, okay, do it this way. So there is a difference between contract of personal service and contract for personal service. And the only service which is out of purview of Consumer Protection Act is contract of personal service. Second point I've already elucidated to, when he's rendering the service to his employer. services by a medical officer attached to a hospital where everyone is seen free. I told you that. A token registration fee, say of 10 rupees or 15 rupees or whatever, it will not alter that position. Services at a non-government hospital where no charges are levied, which means there are charitable institutions, charitable, which are not government institutions, but they are charitable by them, run by NGOs or by trusts or religious bodies. They are all, they do not come under purview of CPA. Services at or by a government hospital where everything is rendered free of charge. Now, there are three tiers of consumer dispute settlement or redressal machinery. CPA vests the District Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. Now, after CPA 2019, this earlier it was called as forum, now it is called as commission. The powers are given to them, which is the same as that of civil court. And the proceedings are deemed to be judicial proceedings. The appellate courts are state commissions and then national commission, and finally the Supreme Court of India. I would not encroach upon Dr. Purvish Parikh's lecture. Suffice it to say that currently the limits are that of for the value of goods or services paid, not the claims that were earlier the basis of the limits which decided whether to go to the district commission or the state commission or the national commission. One point of caution here, that failure to comply with the order of district, state or national commission attracts a punishment of imprisonment, not less than 1 month and not exceeding 3 years, but can extend to 3 years, and a fine which ranges between 25,000 to 1 lakh of rupees. Let us see what criminal negligence is. The objective here is not to get the damages. The objective here is not to settle a claim. The objective here is to punish the doctor, because the law sees that the doctor has been so grossly negligent that he deserves a punishment. So therefore, there is a protection also. The degree of proof required and the evidentiary standards should be beyond an iota of doubt. Beyond an iota of doubt. There should not be doubt. Only then you say that the patient and the doctor has done a criminal negligence. On the other hand, in civil cases, it is the balance of probabilities of the evidentiary standards. And very important is that here, the neglect has to be gross. Gross and culpable neglect. Culpable means blameworthy. Or failure to exercise that reasonable and proper care and precaution to guard against injury, which was imperative duty of the accused. Imperative duty is very important again. I mean, the law says that, okay, this had to be done and you have not done this. Only then it can be termed a criminal negligence. So there are certain sections under which the doctors are covered. 304 is amongst the sessions that are covered, is the most dreadful, which is death caused by rash and negligent act, which does not amount to culpable homicide, which means the patient died. Homicide has been there, but it is not blameworthy. It is not a culpable homicide. It is done by rash and negligent act. And also further protection is that this death should have been the direct result of the negligent act, which the accused is facing. And the act must be proximate and efficient cause without the intervention of another's negligence. Then that means there should be a nexus. There should be, it could be clearly seen. It should be clearly appreciable that this particular act and the death has resulted from that. It is a consequential death of that act. It is punishable by a term of up to 2 years or fine or both. It is cognizable but a bailable offense. What is cognizable? Cognizable is that when the police can arrest you without warrant. By definition, cognizable means very evident, very clear, which you can appreciate as a clearly done thing. The other section that covers are section 336 IPC, where act done rashly or negligently endangers human life or personal safety of others. very important thing to understand here, and the difference between the civil and the criminal law, is that this is punishable even if no harm follows. On the other hand, I've told you that the last thing which needs to be met with for the definition of actionable negligence is that it has to be a consequence of your action. Here, even if no harm follows, you are liable to punishment. For example, you are operating a patient in the OT and the oxygen cylinder is empty. Although the patient might not have needed oxygen, but it's still punishable. Section 337 is causing hurt by rash and negligent act so as to endanger the person's life. If this applies when there is no criminal intent. For example, a gynecologist tries to do termination of pregnancy in the third trimester. There is no intent, criminal intent is not there, but it is a negligent act because you endangered person's life, because you have gone beyond the written rules or written regulations about that. Section 338 is causing grievous hurt, but applies the same way. Now, Supreme Court has distinguished between negligence, rashness, and recklessness in Poonam Verma versus Ashwin Patel case. A negligent person is one who inadvertently commits an act of omission and violates a positive duty. That's about it. The act committed is inadvertent. A person who is rash knows the consequences, but thinks that this will not occur, but foolishly thinks that this will not occur as a result of his or her act. He knows there is foreseeability. He knows that this harm can come, but foolishly thinks that this will not act. He's a person who's rash. But a reckless person knows the consequences, but does not care two hoots. Whether it results from his act, he doesn't care. So the law is very favorable to the doctors in this. What happens practically is completely different. We'll not go into that at all. Otherwise, I go on speaking for next 2 hours. Any conduct falling short of recklessness and deliberate wrongdoing should not be the subject of criminal liability. So rash act also would not qualify to be called as criminal negligence. Again, very important case, Jacob Matthew, which is a landmark judgment, which says that a private complaint of rashness or negligence against a doctor may not be entertained without prima facie evidence in the form of a credible opinion of another competent doctor supporting the charge. So another competent doctor must say that, okay, prima facie, there has been a negligence, prima facie. In addition, it enjoins upon the investigating officer to give an independent opinion, preferably of a government doctor. So unless these 2 points are met, you cannot or you should not act on that complaint. Finally, doctors cannot be arrested in a routine manner. A doctor may be arrested only if the investigating officer believes that he or she would not be available for prosecution unless arrested, which means if the police believes that you would go underground or you would not be available for this, they cannot arrest you. Very recent judgment in December 2018 of Justice Sathashivam and Ranjan Gogoi, Chief Justice later, that no FIR can be filed against a lawyer and by inference against a doctor just because his advice was unacceptable. They have mentioned this. So, as I mentioned, these sections which are applicable to doctors are cognizable but bailable offenses. Now, bail is a matter of right. What is bail? Bail is something that tells you that, okay, you commit to be present when called for the investigation, the case. Police would hold the investigation and also has the authority to arrest without warrant, as I mentioned. Therefore, do not spend time, money, and energy, and do not come in the sweet talks or scary talks of the others, that you go and rush to the court at this stage, because courts at this stage do not have control over the investigative process. They will necessarily return your petition to say that, okay, go back to the police and cooperate with the police. And as I mentioned, the bail is statutory right, cannot even be denied by police. So don't waste time and money in applying to the court for so-called anticipatory bail. What is the legal safety net that we have? Section 81 Indian Penal Code says that it permits causing harm with an intention to avoid greater harm. So you can harm a patient if the intention is there to avoid a greater harm. Whether or not that happens, that is a different issue. And that is why in the first place, the patient would take you to the court. So decision to end life of terminally ill patients, this has been now further strengthened by the law on euthanasia or advanced directive. So decision to end life of terminally ill patients taken deliberately to spare the patient and family from greater harm of futile prolongation of the dying process, adding burdensome, expensive, and often painful treatment. So if that happens, you are protected under Section 81 of IPC. There are counter arguments that what could be the greater harm than putting somebody to sleep, terminal sleep, that is death. But as I mentioned, there are times we all know that when the patient is terminally sick and we know that the patient is going to wake up and lakhs of rupees are spent in the treatment, there's so much of tension to the family, et cetera, et cetera. So that is the greater harm which you want to avoid by causing this harm. Very important thing, actually, I should have made it red, that consent of patient is the most important requirement for this. You must tell the patient that this is what is going to happen. I'm not going to discuss when the patient is not able to give consent, and that is when comes the new law with this. There is advanced directive. Documented medical reasons should also indicate that harm to be avoided far outweighs risk of harm caused by the decision to terminate life. So you must document those reasons in the case sheet. Very, very important. Otherwise, no documentation, no court will entertain. Section 88, again, says that nothing is an offense by reason of any harm it may cause to other, provided that the act is done for the benefit of other in good faith, and he has given express or implied consent to suffer that harm, which I mentioned to you earlier, or to take that risk of that harm, and provided that the doer has no intention to cause death. So the intention is not to cause death in this particular section. Now let's come to briefly how not to get into this cesspool. Remember the five first alphabets of English language, A, B, C, D, and E. Be aware, build structures, communicate, document, and you can see the emphasis that I have given, and empathize. We are going to deliver in the course special one-hour sessions on various aspects, so I'm not going to dilate upon them right now. Suffice it to mention that you should be aware that no one is insulated against lawsuits, that you are primarily responsible for your acts and omissions, that you are vicariously responsible for acts and omissions of your subordinates. Vicariously means that deemed to be have been done by you, which means the act of the agent is deemed to be the act of principal. You must be aware of about the rights of the patients and about your duties. Be aware that about the laws that govern you. See, ignorance of law is no excuse. And ignorance, the law does not excuse anybody's ignorance. You must be aware, what are your defenses? As I mentioned to you, that these are your defenses. You know, the doctors are not aware what defenses they can take. Very important today. And I must tell you that 95% of lawsuits filed have your own colleague behind them. So if you criticize your colleague today, it may be your turn tomorrow. I would like you to please copy this slide, copy this line. That's very, very, very important. And live this line, breathe this line. Please stop criticizing your colleagues. Don't score brownie points. Build structures. What does that mean? You should have consents. These are the structures which form the foundation of your case. Pointers showing that you did the due diligence by sifting past records. See the certificates. Family meeting records must be maintained and made. Very important is that do not alter material facts on patient's request. Now, what is material fact? Material fact is that fact which, if suppressed, could have changed the decision taken by the doctor or by the patient. So do not alter material facts. For example, the patient comes because of the insurance problem, says, sir, I've been drinking, but please do not mention it. And the guy is down with cirrhosis of liver. Well, you cannot hide, because then you will be hauled up for concealing this particular fact. Be on guard always, because every patient is a potential litigant. Communicate. Be a good listener and communicate in a language that the patient understands. State the facts as they are without overt sentiments. Just be firm but polite. Sentimentality should be avoided. Prognosticate correctly and realistically. There are many times you say, oh, theek ho jayega ji, bilkul first class ho jayega. But you know that the patient is not going to get better. So prognosticate correctly. At the same time, do not even scare that I don't know, there are only 1% chance of his survival. What I'm trying to say, if there are 1% chance, please say that. But it has to be realistic and correct. Body language sometimes conveys far more than your words. So communication, body language is very, very important. In sick patients, communicate frequently. Again, the law enjoins upon you to communicate with the patient and only because maintaining confidentiality is mandated by law. In India, everybody comes and says, I'm his cousin, I'm his friend, I'm his employer, so you must tell me. No, please. Document, I can't overemphasize that. Document is the only savior you have once a case is filed against you. It is paramount importance the document is. They say that good documentation means good defense, poor documentation means poor defense, and no documentation means no defense. You are doomed. There should be detailed notes in subjective, objective assessment and plan pattern. Procedure and surgery notes should be detailed. Be objective and not very vague. And now, again, this one special lecture would be taken for this. So I'm not going to go into those details. But salient points I'm going to touch, do not cook up, do not change. Write an addendum instead. You might have written something inadvertently, but you want to change. So do not overwrite or cook up the things after the patient has gone or there has been an unsuccessful outcome. You must write at the same time, write addendum and do not overwrite. Hard copies of consents must be preserved. Very important things. Again, the certificate is a legal document. So do not issue a certificate in a jiffy. Do not certificate under pressure, as has been a case in Riya Chakravarti's case. A doctor has issued a certificate while not seeing her and is in soup right now. The family briefings must be signed by the family themselves, the members themselves who are present along with you. Tomorrow they cannot turn around and say, this was not explained to me. Again, doctor's notes and nurse's notes must tally, because sometimes what happens is that you find that the patient is febrile, right? That patient is having 101 fever. And at the same time, the staff nurse has mentioned there is no fever. Or the staff nurse has mentioned the doctor has dictated me this. So make sure, train your nurses that doctor's notes and nurse's notes must tally. write reflective notes, give rational and reasonable explanations of why you're doing it. Again, very, very important. I cannot overemphasize that. Document the communication that you have communicated it to the patient or the family. And communicate that I have documented whatever I have spoken to you. Because this happens, this acts as a real deterrent. Later on, they cannot say, don't lie ever, because you don't have to remember the truth. Empathy and compassion have won many a battle, so empathize with the patient. Expect unreasonable, irrational responses for patients when they are under stress and grief. Somebody dies. They would obviously be angry. They would obviously be stern. They would obviously be rude. But understand that. Do not overreact. Avoid direct confrontation. Be firm, but at the same time, be polite. You know that the patient is suffering or the family is suffering. As I mentioned, a body language, a sympathetic touch, and sympathetic hearing can avert a lawsuit. There are certain other things which you must be careful about. Indemnity is a must. Take an indemnity insurance. Malpractice insurance is a must in today's day and age. Insure heavily, because the indemnity insurance doesn't come very expensive. The premium are not very high. Take 1:1 policy. What does that mean? Take any one accident in any 1 year policy. Do not take 1:4, which means that the sum assured is then divided into 4 accidents. And 4 accidents, you'll be too unlucky to have 4 accidents in a row in 1 year. Hospital policies usually cover full-time employees. So if you're visiting, please take your own insurance. Very important again is your credentialing should be up to date. What I mean by that is that if you are doing a new procedure and you have got the certification, you must be credentialed by the credentialing body of the hospital. If you're not credentialed, that goes against you. Other safeguards are that in consultation clinics, small nursing homes, train your staff to be alert to aggression from outside. It is very, very bad that things are happen. People take law into their hands, they damage, they beat up the doctors. So you must train them beforehand. Install CCTV cameras, security systems, and panic buttons. Make groups of colleagues so that you can broadcast your problem when there's an emergency. In complicated cases, do not deny. In fact, you should welcome a suggestion by the patient that he wants to take a second opinion. Don't think that it's an ego. Don't take it on your ego. Do not deny the patient a second opinion when he asks for it. Call another expert, especially during surgery. If the situation is such that it's a tricky situation, it's not that you're incompetent, but there are many tricky situations which come during the surgery. So call another expert. You share the responsibility. Encourage formal peer reviews of the cases where the outcome has not been very successful. And as far as practical and possible, refrain from giving an opinion on phone, especially in a new patient. Now, the new telemedicine guidelines have come. Please keep those in mind before doing anything. Practical things, know the local area SHO, very important. Visit him Diwali. Be active in local branch IMA and other professional and social bodies, because networking helps. I thank you for your attention with a small cryptic message that it's never too late to change your profession. But, well, that is it. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, sir, for the wonderful talk. We have quite a few questions and comments pouring in. Many of them are just appreciation comments. So with that, we can now move on to the Q&A session. So before we start taking
I'll stop sharing my slides.
Yes, sir, sure. So before we start taking questions, just a couple of pointers, mainly for the audience. So we have already probably a list of 20-25 questions with us. Now, it may not be possible for us to take all the questions within the allocated time in this particular session. But please keep sending your questions, and please be assured that we will be taking those questions as well in the subsequent sessions. Also, we have a dedicated panel discussion in the sixth session where we can, you know, take up all the questions. So we will be collecting all your questions and answering them for sure. So with that, I'll be starting with the questions. So the first question is from Dr. Kaur. If a patient wants to leave the hospital on his own without the consent of the treating doctor, can he insist for a discharge and treatment summary or say operating notes, etc.? Will he be within his rights to do so?
Yes. Notes are a right of the patient. The only thing is that you have to, the patient has to apply for those in writing that he wants the notes. So you will have to give that, made those notes available within 72 hours of his application. Whatever you've done, notes are the right of the patient.
So now we have a couple of questions actually, which are talking about this law of torts that you have mentioned in your presentation. Now, they're mainly asking for examples from various specialties. Some of them have asked for vascular surgeries or cardiology. So if you could just give maybe some broad examples of where it comes and how.
As an example, I mean, there can be innumerable examples, but the question is how, what is treated as negligence? As I mentioned, there are certain things which complications occur in every patient, right? Now, let us say, I'm sorry, I'm a gastroenterologist. I would just give you an example that comes to my mind, that one is doing a colonoscopy and there's a perforation. There's a complication, right? That is not negligence. But if you overlook that and you feel that, okay, nothing will happen, go home, and do not act on that particular complication, that is what comes under negligence. Complications are inherent in almost everything. In trying to explain the risks when you take the consent, I take this line always that the patient doesn't even come to his mind that he has taken a risk before he comes to see you, because he can meet with an accident, he crossing the road, right? So there is an inherent complication, inherent risk, not complication, inherent risk even when the patient comes to see you. So you can tell that every single action, every single procedure is attended by certain risks, right? So I will not be able to give you examples from various specialties, because these are the general things which you must be must take care of or must be aware of.
Understood. Now the next question is from Dr. Preeti from Hyderabad. So she's asking, as a medical professional, is there any law where which I can use in my support, where I can take legal actions or file a complaint against the patients if required?
See, you are a citizen first and a doctor later. So all those rights which the constitution gives you, which the legal framework gives you, you are free to use them. Say somebody beats you up, well, certainly, yes, you can go and file an FIR. You can file an FIR of intimidation even if somebody threatens you on phone. Right? So all those laws are available to you as much as to anybody else. But let us say that you find that the complaint against you, you are wronged, and the complaint against you is frivolous. Unfortunately, in the current Consumer Protection Act, this frivolous complaint is not being awarded to the complainant. Is not punished for that. Punished, I mean, a fine is not imposed on that. In CPA 1986, there was a pittance of a fine which was 5,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees, up to 10,000 rupees could have been imposed on the patient who the judge found that was frivolous in nature. This has been done away with. But this would be discussed by Dr. Purvesh Parikh in his talk, I think 3 weeks from now. Have I lost you? Hello? Can you hear me and can you see me? I lost you in a bit. Yeah.
Yes, I got probably disconnected, sir. I'm sorry about that. Okay, so got it. The next question, actually, you have already answered it. So there was a question about whether the consumer protection law actually has anything specific about the doctors, but that has already been covered, I guess.
Yes.
So now, a very interesting question. I think this you were pondering about that before the session started. Is it possible to practice medicine and law together by Dr. Pritam Gupta?
I was discussing it before we started the talk. I was discussing with Mr. Raja Reddy that there is a law which says there is a law which says there is a Supreme Court judgment that you cannot simultaneously or parallelly follow these two professions. You can either be a doctor or be a lawyer. So there are people who've done law degree, LLB, and are practicing law only and only after surrendering their registration with Medical Council of India. Only then they will be admitted in the Bar Council of India. So you cannot parallelly do this. You could consult, of course, but you cannot attend the courts. That's what I'm saying.
So now the next question is about documentation. Is it mandatory to take in writing each time we explain to the patient the prescription that we are giving, or to make sure that the patient has understood how to take the medicine? Is that a requirement to take all these details in writing as well?
You are now required to safeguard your records, you're required to preserve your records, even on the OPD records, if I've understood the question correctly. So it is best to explain in the prescription itself that how the medication needs to be taken, how that particular procedure needs to be done, etc. And you keep a copy of that. And currently, because of the very widespread use of computers and software, it's not a difficult thing at all. There are templates which you can make and explaining the patient that particular medication, how to be taken before the meal, after the meal or something. I hope I've got the question correct.
My understanding of the question is, he has verbally explained the medicine and how to take it to the patient. Now, whether it's important to take a disclaimer from the patient that I have understood that in writing. Is that a requirement?
No. I think that will be carrying the things too far. Because if you want to be very, very sure, just write a note that explained. That's about it. Yeah. I can understand that the prescription usually is in English. I can understand the prescription usually in English. But I have seen many prescriptions by the various doctors that where they explain in vernacular that, okay, this is how it has to be taken. Aap khane ke baad leni hai, garam pani se leni hai. You know, something of that they write. That will be helpful.
Okay, the next question is about, so is a situation, for example, a patient had an anaphylactic reaction after taking a medicine or after prescribing something, which was not foreseen by the doctor, of course. Now, if the patient comes back and blames the doctor, what could be the actionable or what could be the steps that be taken from the doctor by the doctor?
Sorry?
In case there is an anaphylactic reaction after taking a medicine as per the prescription given by a doctor, which was, of course, unforeseen by the doctor himself, but then what are the actions the doctor can take to safeguard himself if the patient comes back and blames them for having that side effect?
So usually the practice which I follow is that as a kind of, in the instructions, it is written that the common side effects have been explained to the patient, but anaphylaxis is not a common side effect, right? Foreseeability is there, but unforeseen things are completely different, right? Foreseeability may be there with any medicine or any something that anaphylactic reaction may occur, right? And this thing has to be taken care of more by the dispensing doctors, because there are many clinics where they inject also. Now, if they inject and there is anaphylaxis, they are supposed to have antidotes there itself. They are supposed to have all those things around them, which if anaphylaxis reaction occurs in the clinic, they can deal with. Especially what those people who are dispensing the medication, are injecting the medication.
Okay. Sure. There is one specific question about a word, phrase that you have mentioned in your slides, soap pattern, in the communication slide, I believe, SOAP, yeah. Soap pattern. So they want to know what that means.
So soap pattern is subjective, S, objective. Subjective means what the patient complains, what the history is. Objective, what you see, and what is your final assessment, and on the basis of which, what the plan, P is plan of action.
Right. Okay, sir. So actually, we have already reached 8. So we have all a lot of questions left, and more questions are still pouring in. So as I said before, we will be taking a note of all these questions and keeping them for future references. We will be taking them in the future sessions.
I would request you also to please take these questions and maybe email it to me. We can actually collate them and then give it to the various experts also, and deal with it in the last session also.
Definitely, sir. We'll do that for sure. So now actually we have come to the last part of our presentation, which is basically the quiz. This is the quiz questionnaire which was shared with you before the session has started. Many of you have attended it. Thank you so much for everyone who has participated. So these are the right answers. I'm showing it on the screen. So the first question was, which of the following statements is incorrect? The answer is the option number A, which is the standard of care acceptable in law. Is that the highest degree available in that field? The second question was, which of the following is true for criminal negligence? The answer, the right answer here is option number 3. The negligence has to be gross for it to be considered as criminal negligence. And the last question was, which of the following statements is correct? And the right answer is the 4th one. Error of judgment is not negligence. Now, it is time for us to declare the names of the top 3 scorers for this quiz. Again, my thanks, sincere thanks to all those who have participated. And in case you have not participated, please do participate in the future quizzes that we're going to send out very soon. These are the three top scorers for this today's quiz. Dr. Sundari Srikant, Dr. Arvind Dambalkar from Delhi, and Dr. Chandrasekhar V. Joshi from Mumbai. Now, if you look at the scores, they have all answered all the questions correctly. So the way this ranking has been made is the earliest responder have been placed in the first rank. As the course moves forward, we will be having one quiz each week, and then there will be one final winner declared on 12th December, who will have a chance to have a one-to-one discussion with Dr. Setya about any medical legal queries that they have. They can have.
No, all probably experts. All experts. They'll be happy to have that interaction.
So here again, I must thank you, Dr. Setya, again for your excellent presentation. Lots of insights and very practical learnings that people can take from this session. And we are just getting started with the course. The next few sessions will be also very interesting. The next session we have scheduled is on 15th of November. That is about consent and documentation. And as Dr. Sethi has repeatedly mentioned in his presentation, it cannot be overemphasized. So do attend the session. Do not miss it. The next quiz will also go live on 12th of November. Our sales colleagues will reach out to you with the quiz links, and the link will also be available in the portal office. And in case you want to revisit the course, in case you want to come back and go through the video again, please feel free to do so. The session recordings will be available till the end of the course. In case somebody has missed to attend the live session, they can also come here, come to the portal, register, and watch the course at their leisure. So with that, I thank you, sir, again for spending your valuable time. Thanks to all the participants who have taken out time from their busy schedules to attend this on a Saturday evening. And we end for the session today and hope to see you in the next session.
I thank each one of you at the backstage, each one of you who have made this possible, and above all, the audience who have come in such large numbers. I really am overwhelmed and I'm humbled. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you, sir. Kaustav, is the live feed stopped?